Another important tool in Inkscape is text. Of course, it's important to be able to add some text in your picture graphics. For example, we want to add a rectangle. Okay. For the text, there are different properties. We can use normal, italic, bold, and so on. We can select font family, for example, Times New Roman, size. Column. We can add them a control with shift by clicking on the column. Okay. What else? You can work with this text with the normal text. You can change the register. For example, you want to write e to the power x in italic, and we want that x goes up. Okay, you can do like this. Of course, as a scientist or engineer, you would like to be able to write, for example, some Greek letters. Okay. To do so, it's easy simply to use Unicode. I type Ctrl U O 3 B C and gives mu. I type Ctrl U O 3 C 0, it gives pi, and so on. So you can find easily tables of Greek letters for Inkscape. It's just Unicode for Greek letters. And in order to type Unicode, you need to simply type Ctrl U first and type the Unicode of Greek letters. But of course, there are, you would like to introduce some equations in your graphs. For example, we want to plot something. We want to create artificial plot, and this axis, for example, it's some quantity. To add equations, you need to go to extension, and the classical extension that's available in all distributions of Inkscape. If it finds some TechLife distribution, it will work. So we can add formula. For example, we want to say that x-axis, it's x equal to some integral from a to b, some function f of x dx, and we change the font size. Click OK. It inserts equations in the middle of the page. I remove snapping. And here on this line, you would like to add something else. Say that y is equal to sum from 0 to n whatever. We'll add equation. Let's rotate it. Okay. And we can add some data points. Okay, in order to change font to add something, you can go to advanced settings of this formula PDF LaTeX and add here whatever you want. Use any font you would like to. And here I show which fonts are available in LaTeX. Of course, those are not the full list of smooth fonts. The full list could be found in this reference. And now with this equations, you cannot really modify it, but there are some extra plugins which could be used to add modifiable equations in your Inkscape creations.
What I can do now, I can change the color, of course. I can change whatever I want, because now it's
simply a pass. You see, you have control points, you can remove, move, ungroup it all. I can put it like this if I wish. So we can do some modification, but you cannot retype the equation. Group it. That's it about equations and text in LaTeX.
Okay, a few more things I would like to show you about Inkscape, which I didn't show in the previous lessons. So the first thing is how to arrange objects. Let's take a few figures and embed into Inkscape documents. Okay. So let's resize them to have the same height. And I would like to group this object along a single line and to have equal spacing between them. To do so, I will align them according to selection area at the central line, and there are different objects or different options on how to distribute them. For example, we can keep the same distance between the centers. Okay, in this way it's a line. It's appropriate for equally sized objects, but not for differently sized objects. So therefore it would be better to keep the equal distance between different objects like this. Okay, now they are perfectly aligned and also the spacing between objects remains the same. Okay. If you want to align by the inner two rows, to do so we will scale a little bit this one. Next we'll align this right side images by the right side, left side images by the left side, and we'll ensure equal spacing between these three figures. So now we resize the content. Now these figures are nicely aligned, nicely arranged into a good array. If you want to add some ABC size 24, we can easily do so. And it would be nice to align this ABC as well. For example, we can align them. So we can align every A like this, going to the left side of the image. And now we can move it. So now we know that A and B are equally distant from lower and left side of the every image. Of course, here it's not very well visible, but make it black. And we can add CDE here. Okay. Another thing I would like to show you, it's how to annotate images and how to save it in a proper way. Let's import a scanning microscope image. And we'd like to show it's a fracture surface, and we'd like to show material orientation on this figure. We'll draw a line, straight line, make it thicker and make it wide, and it will be a narrow. Okay, let's make it even more thick too, and we can add some orientation. Let's add one more orientation. I make Ctrl G to duplicate the object, and I draw a line orthogonal to this one. Ctrl C, Ctrl V. This direction will be G direction. Ctrl D to duplicate. F2 to change the control points. To draw a perfectly vertical line, I select both control points and I make a vertical alignment. And here it will be S direction. And now here, if you wish, you can even make some measurements. So you know this is 100 micron distance, right? So let's make it a little bit thicker. So we know that this distance is 100 microns, and so it corresponds to the width of 22 millimeters on this plot, on this image. Therefore, we can compute, if you wish, that remove snapping. We can compute the thickness of the specimen. Okay, here's the thickness. We can. So the width now is 156, 157, and the height is 80. So by squaring this one and this one, by summing up, by taking the square root, we can obtain distance on the image, and using the proportion we can obtain what would be the distance, the true distance in microns. Okay, now the object is annotated, so we put everything that we needed, and it would be a good idea to save it as Inkscape format SVG. Because on the later stages, at some point, if you realize that, for example, it was not the L direction and this is not a T, but vice versa, it will be easier to change. And of course, it's not possible to do so, to do it so easily in raster graphics, right? So it's a good idea to keep this annotated map images in SVG format or PDF format, which is editable. Okay. The next thing I would like to show you is how to do some virtual measurements on a specimen. Okay, let's open a photo. We'll open a photo. Specimen. Now we'd like to scale it in such a way. So this is 10 centimeters, right? And the length here is 332 centimeters. To make it 10, we need to divide by 332 and multiply by 10. So 10 divided by 332067. This works nicely. Let's select it. Now we select everything. We change to percent and we'll use so we scale so it becomes now so we took 3% of the original size and now this line change the units this line oh it's no I was wrong it's 1 centimeter now okay let's change the size again so we 1000 okay and now this line should be exactly or almost exactly 10 centimeters right so we need to do of course it's more carefully in order to but in order to measure real sizes real dimensions but at least I'll demonstrate an idea here so now if I draw a line okay its size height is 0.8 centimeters so the thickness of the sample the diameter of the specimen is 0.8 centimeters okay and also you can measure even the radius of curvature to do so I will draw a circle and we'll try to find the best fit so it looks to fit quite well and the size of 2.3 centimeters okay, this kind of virtual measurements could be done on any tool if you have a ruler or have an idea of the size. Another thing I would like to show you is how to convert bitmap in vector. I already show some examples, but I will show some more. Sometimes it's very easy. Let's take a logo of our laboratory in a raster format. You can see pixels here. And to convert this logo into a vector, it's very easy to do. So we'll go to Path, Trace Bitmap. Select multicolor colors. There are three colors. And we'll remove the background. Background is white. Apply. Okay, now we have a nice logo traced by Inkscape. Okay. You can see there are a few control points. Now we can change the color if you wish. However, about the text, often it's never perfect on this automatic conversion because you see R is strange, P is strange, so it's better to use the closest font to find the closest font which corresponds to the text. Alright, this was the first example. Another example, when it's easy, is for example for this kind of figures. So I would like to convert this raster image into vector image. I do a single scan with a brightness cutoff line, and now I can operate on this object, draw a contour. Yes, now it's vector object. Pretty easy to obtain. To separate these two parts, I will need simply go to path, break apart, and now these two parts are separated. Okay.
Now let me show you how we can extract some figures or information from PDF articles. Sometimes the PDF articles are not editable, very old, like this one. But for example, I'm interested in extracting this figure. Okay. So you see it's not vector graphics, even though it's PDF, it's a raster graphics, and to extract this one, I make a print screen of this part. I can bring this print screen into Inkscape and try to trace this bitmap. Okay, let's trace bitmap. It's not perfect, but well, it's not bad. So we can remove details that we don't need. This one, and we get a nice illustration which could be reused if needed. We can break them apart. Okay, when we break apart all these non-simply connected stuff, looks like this, so not very handy. Okay, this one example. Another example, just a suggestion, an idea. Sometimes we need to present someone's data. Okay, for example, I would like to show in my presentation these experimental results. However, all these curves are annotated not in the legend in the box here, but in the caption for the figure. And it's not a good idea to present it in the presentation in this way. A better idea would be to create something like this. I just insert the figure from this presentation and I slightly modify it in a way that I add a legend in this way, so the people can easily understand which line corresponds to which material data. Okay. So what I did, I simply draw on the top of these squares, I draw extra squares on the top of these triangles, I draw extra triangles, and annotated every curve. The same I did with this paper by Jean-Louis Chabosch. So I needed to show this curve, but I wanted to highlight this deformation curve for the lowest rate and for the highest rate. To do so, I simply took this part of this PDF and added splines on the top and highlighted this strain rate and this one in order to simplify to the audience to understand, to grasp the information in a rapid way. Okay, it's about old PDF papers. However, for a newer one, everything that's inserted in the PDF here, it's in vector format, and I hope you see it's a selectable text, and I can extract these data points if I need to use it to present my data or model or whatever. Let me take this PDF. Sorry.
div, insert here. I don't need all the pages, I'll take only the second one. So I will ungroup everything, Ctrl U. And now I can select data points which I'm interested in. For example, I'm interested in red points. I will select same by fill color. Okay, selected. I will select axis as well. Control C. I selected too many things. It's not what I wanted. I wanted to select and group it once again. Now I'd like to select now. Yes. Select same fill color. Okay, now it's selected only what I need with the axis. Okay. Now I have all the data points which were red here and the axis. So I know the axis, y axis from 0 to 1, x axis from 10 to the power minus 5 to the power to 1, and so I can plot my data on the top of it. If I don't have the data from this paper available in a readable format. Okay. One more example. I would like to extract data, experimental data, from this plot. Okay, you can see it's vector graphics to some extent, but data points are not vector graphics, those are pixels. So, yes, I can import this here and try to extract these data points by drawing a frame by putting the data points manually on the top of these data points. And so on. And so if I locate it properly and I scale it properly, by taking the coordinates of these points, I can extract the data points. But in the internet, there are better tools to do so. I invite you to visit this web project, Webplot Digitizer, which works very well and it's very easy to use to extract numerical data from this kind of files. Few more things I would like to demonstrate to you. It's how to modify PDF, for example. Sometimes we need to modify PDF. And to do so, let me take a PDF file. I will show example on a single page. This PDF. So what we can do? Let me ungroup everything, and now I can modify object one by one. You can see the text was split into independent letters, and it's not easy to change the text. It's not a Word document, right? But we can change blocks of text, for example, input my new email. Okay, you can check the what. There is no font. It's Times New Roman. You can select Times New Roman, and the size is about 11. So I can change my email address. I can remove parts of the text, but I cannot change the text on its own. What else I can do here? For example, see nearest logo. It's in raster graphics.
I would like to put it in vector.
I will insert vector logo and replace it here. For example, and save it as a PDF. To save it as a PDF, let me take file, save a copy. Page one. I will embed fonts. Okay, and now you have a new page with a vector logo of CNRS with my new address and so on. There are a few more things I would like to show you. The first thing is how to recover numerical data from a plot. In research, there are so many information hidden in plots like this, and the data is not available with the paper. So I would like to show you how to recover these data points. Actually, you can do it using Inkscape. The first, it's not very easy, but it's possible. So you can draw axis. So in a way that it coincides with the axis in the paper, and here you can add points. Right, and if you move it properly, then 0, 0 location, and you recover the coordinates of these points, you can reconstruct the data. But there are a simpler way that could be used. There is a VPD tool created by some nice people. VPD stands for Web Plot Digitizer, and I will show you rapidly how to use it. Let's select a file. It's this one. It's XY plot in 2D. And the first thing that it suggests us is to align axis. We need to put two points on X axis and Y axis. Let's start. I will go fast, so not very accurate, but there is a nice zoom window on the right. Okay, four points. The X axis is in log scale. Okay, the minimal value is e to the power minus 9, the maximum value is to the power minus 2, and on Y axis it goes up to 5 to the power minus 3. We can assume that it's perfectly aligned, or not, it will automatically rotate it. Okay, and now if you click on data points, I'm not very careful here, but just to demonstrate you the idea. Okay, and now this data could be viewed, could be copied to clipboard or download as SSV file, CSV file. Okay. That's it. Okay. Another thing I would like to show you is how to insert a signature in a document.
It's often needed for administrative work. For example, I prepared a document which I would like to sign. Let me incorporate this document in Inkscape. We will center it, align and distribute on the page. And I would like to add my signature here, insert my signature. So I signed the paper, I took a photo. So I would like to insert my signature here in the document. Of course, here is a gray background. I would like to make it white. To do so, I will use some filters from Inkscape for raster images, and I will adjust the contrast. I increase the contrast and lightness of the figure, so you drag it here. Okay, now the background is white. I will create a frame around my signature. Select both objects, object, clip, set clip. Okay, and I have my signature. I will make it smaller, but of course, if you make it manually without doing something, you can change the proportion, which is not good. Therefore, when you scale, always press on Control, hold Control button, and scale the image. Oops. Okay. I will make it small. Now I can save a copy, a PDF copy of this image with embedded fonts, and now I have a PDF signed. All right. And the last example I would like to demonstrate to you is how to. It's a kind of joke example, but I would like to send a message, some secret message to someone. And I want to hide it in a PDF file. How to do so? A secret message could be colored in white. Okay, but if I export PDF with embedded text, this text, even if it's white, it will be selectable. Therefore, I will convert it to path. Okay, now it's a path. You can see I can select object and modify points. Okay, now let me hide this text. I will hide this text. Behind a white background. I group them, and now on the top of it I can write, not a secret message. So now if I save it as a PDF, with embedded fonts. Okay, now I close it. I have a document with not secret message, which everybody can read and open. Okay, but if I wish to recover a secret message, I will open it in Inkscape. I will ungroup it all, and you see there's something hidden here, and this one is my secret message. Okay, of course it's a joke, but it's how you can a way that you can use Inkscape. Finally, to finish this to finish this last lesson on introduction in Inkscape to Inkscape, I will show you how Inkscape stores all this information about objects. I will draw a circle at 25 locations of diameter 50 with a contour in black, and I will draw a rectangle here which will be red with a contour in blue. Okay, let me save this document as Inkscape. There was another one.
And now let me show you how it looks like this document. Ours was it?
So this document is here.
Inside it looks
like a XML document with some properties, and you see I have two objects here in the document. I have a circle located 50-50 with radius 25. Here's the color of the fill color, thickness of the stroke, put it 1, stroke color, and I have a rectangle with the coordinates, with the width and heights, and so on. And if you know how to script,
you can script
very nice objects, very complex objects. Like, for example, you can add thousands of objects, locate the special locations. For example, I will draw a red circle located 150-150 with radius 50. With a stroke in blue. Okay, I will save the subject. I close this one without saving. Oops, where is it? And I will open it again. And now you see there is a circle with a blue contour located where I asked him it to be located. That's it. Okay, it's over for this course. I thank you for your attention, and I hope it could be useful for some of you. Bye.